வணக்கம். A spectre is haunting our planet, the spectre of climate change. All of the powers of the world have entered into a holy alliance to encourage the spectre. Oil baron and banker, capitalist and imperialist, fascist and liberal. The planet is heating up. Ecosystems are being destroyed at an alarming rate, from the Amazon to the oceans. Thousand-year climate calamities occur every other year. Floods drown the coasts as droughts ravage the fields. All this destruction while capitalists rake up profits higher than ever before. Governments and international agencies debate about the semantics of the problem and ignore the oncoming collapse. Worst of all, the system has convinced all of us that we are the problem, and taking part in performative actions is enough to save the world. You see, we are How are we, you ask? In this video, we discuss the current state of climate change and the effects on the health of us humans. Before we begin, I realize that any discussion regarding climate change is depressing and extremely dry. To give you an incentive to keep watching, I promise to punctuate this video with introductions to many of my cats. Here are Kitty Boy, Jugnu, and Moiraine to start us off. We need to acknowledge the immense amount of influence that climate change deniers have when it comes to information. Any credible evidence is immediately refuted with think tank reports saying that everything is actually getting better. So, for this video, I'm showing the most credible evidence that we have so far. Introducing the IPCC. Set up in 1988, the panel is essentially a large group of scientists who review and condense all the science related to climate change. Unlike most environmental consultancies bought out by private equity firms, they don't really have a conflict of interest when it comes to protecting the environment. The seventh cycle of the assessment is currently ongoing, so the reports we have are from the sixth assessment cycle. The primary report discussed here is the AR6 synthesis report published in 2023. Before getting into the report, here are Ptolemy, Renarin, and Thessaloniki taking a nap. It can be said with a high degree of confidence that human activities, principally through the emission of greenhouse gases, have caused global warming. The report gives the level at 1.1 degrees above pre-industrial levels in the year 2020, half a decade ago. In 2023, it crossed 1.45 degrees. They also note that global surface temperatures have increased faster in the last 50 years than any other period over the last 2000 years. Let's give this some more perspective and look at the net emissions of carbon dioxide over time. Of the total emissions in the last 170 years, 58% happened over the first 140-year period and 42% happened in just the last 30 years. The atmospheric carbon dioxide concentration is higher than any point in the last 2 million years, and methane and nitrous oxide higher than any time in the last 800,000 years. Net emissions in 2019 were 12% higher than 2010 and 54% higher than 1990, with the largest growth coming from fossil fuel combustions and industries. Something else to note is that the contribution of these emissions aren't all equal over time and geography. The average per capita emission of carbon dioxide is 6.9 ton equivalents. Least developed countries emit just 1.7, and the small island nations, whose very existence is threatened by climate change, emit just 4.6, well below the global average. The emissions also vary greatly within countries. The 10% of households with the highest per capita emissions contribute 35 to 45% of emissions, while the bottom 50% contribute just 13 to 15%. We need to look at the emissions historically too. This is the map of emissions currently. While it is easy to blame China and India for the state, looking at historical emissions changes the map to this. With that out of the way, let's move on to changes and impacts after quickly checking on equine. The report acknowledges that human-induced climate change has caused widespread and rapid changes on the planet. Hundreds of species have been lost and there have been mass mortality events recorded both on land and sea. Though the report doesn't mention it, this is otherwise referred to as the sixth mass extinction or the Anthropocene extinction. The other effects on the world are larger and more widespread, from water availability, reduced crop production, and wildfires. The next part of the report talks about progress in adaptation. It essentially says that some amount of adaptation has happened, but it's fragmented, incremental, and unequally distributed across regions. Most of the current models estimate that we will cross 1.5 degrees in the near future. Each incremental increase in temperature has disastrous effects on the environment. The 2020 climate fiction novel, The Ministry for the Future, starts with a scenario where an intense heat wave kills thousands of people in the Gangetic Plain. When I read it a year ago, it seemed like something that would happen far into the future. But after this record-breaking summer with heat waves, something like this is probably going to happen much sooner. I know I've dunked on Lancet in the past, but the convoluted state of the publishing industry forces me to come back to it. Every year, The Lancet publishes a report called The Lancet Countdown, essentially bringing together all the science related to health and climate change. With the next report expected in a couple of months, I'm going to try and summarize the 2024 report. Before we get into it though, here is Konstantin Konstantinovich Rokossovsky. The report highlights that people in every single country face a threat from climate change. We could actually see this over the past year, where so many countries in the imperial core were also affected. The first indicator looked at is heat and health. To start with, infants and older adults experienced an average 13.8 days of heat wave per person. That is 8 to 9 days more than 2005. In 2023, all of us were exposed to a record high of 1,512 hours where the ambient heat posed at least a moderate risk of heat stress during light outdoor exercise. Couple of things to note. Firstly, light exercise includes walking, so essentially most people who are outdoors at any point. This is also 27% higher than 1999. The next indicator is a little more nuanced. So the indicator itself shows that 512 billion potential work hours were lost, 49% above 1999. The thing is, this indicator assumes that once temperatures get too high, people would stop working, something good capitalists obviously wouldn't let their workers do. This makes this indicator much more sinister for the 1.6 billion people of working age who work outdoors. Also to be noted that 63% of the potential work hours lost were in agriculture. Tired after a hard day's work? Too bad. Climate change has increased sleep hours lost by 6%. Blessed be those in Northwest Australia, Central South Africa, and Central Brazil who are actually sleeping better. The inspiration for the Ministry for the Future is also evident. In 2023, we faced 50 more days of health-threatening heat than that expected without climate change. And this is a conservative estimate. In 31 countries, this is more than 100 days. And this does translate into mortality. Take the elderly for example. Heat-related deaths have increased by 167%. Heating affects us indirectly too. The rising temperatures have increased risk of wildfires in 124 countries. Almost half the entire global land area was also affected by at least a month of extreme drought, and 61% saw an increase in extreme precipitation events. The droughts were responsible for 151 million more people experiencing moderate to severe food insecurity. 3.8 billion people were also exposed to higher than ideal particulate matter from sand and dust storms. All this heat also makes us much sadder. Before leaving heat behind, here is Vale. I named her that after a summer that certainly was cooler than this year's. Tropical medicine is soon going to be back in fashion. I can say this with absolute certainty, owing to the increased likelihood of transmission of dengue, malaria, vibrio, and West Nile virus. This is also going to be an interesting spiral, considering that healthcare sector emissions have also increased rapidly over the past few years. There is also the issue of inequality at the root of this crisis. Everything I have discussed above is and will continue to affect the marginalized the most. Poorer countries suffer more than richer countries, and the poor within countries will suffer more than the rich. Though both face the same level of increase in temperature, a banker handling oil stocks from an air-conditioned office in the city of London will have it so much easier than a daily wage labourer from Cuddalore. Those causing climate change have the least to lose from this. We're going to skip back to the IPCC AR6 report for this one. They say right at the outset that the way forward has to be net zero carbon dioxide emissions. So how much time do we have? Well, every 1,000 gigatons of CO2 raises the global temperature by about 0.45 degrees. Starting from 2020, we have then about 500 gigatons for a 50% likelihood to limit it to 1.5 degrees and 1,150 for limiting it to 2 degrees. So given that this is a carbon budget, if we keep the same level of emissions as 2019. By 2030, we would have eaten our way through the entire budget for 1.5 degrees and third of that remaining for 2 degrees. All the modeled pathways involve rapid, deep, and immediate greenhouse gas emissions reductions in all sectors this decade. We are halfway through this decade and haven't really started. There is a rapidly closing window of opportunity to secure a future for all. Here's what that looks like over the years. To limit it to 1.5 degrees, we need to reach net zero by 2050 and cut down by half by 2030. Even to limit it to 2 degrees, we need to bring down by 73% by 2050. Unlike Paridhi, content at growling at the retreating southwest monsoons, the report acknowledges that changes required are unprecedented in terms of scale, but not necessarily in terms of speed. In other words, there must be weeks where decades happen. While the report suggests a number of ways that we can try and tackle the problem, central to the way we deal with it should be equity and social justice. The current path that we are going on is not solving the problem in any way. Even burning all the oil we have discovered to this date overshoots the limit by a high amount. In the global age of drill baby drill, companies are still discovering more oil. Green capitalism puts the onus of change on us and lets the structures that are continuing this damage run free. Saving the planet from this is going to be hard. I have tried two interesting models. The first is an online game based on a book called Half Earth Socialism. It starts in a utopia where the revolution has swept the world and we are in charge of stopping climate change. It's incredibly difficult even with the best of circumstances where we start from. I've been playing it for a year now and still haven't managed to beat it on my own terms. The second is a board game called Daybreak. Here, players take charge of different national blocks and work cooperatively to try and tackle climate change. Even here, with the entire world cooperating, it's hard to survive. All of this without oil barons, neoliberal think tanks, and other lobbies advocating for business as usual. Even Kalinda agrees and proceeds to make propaganda. I have barely scratched the surface on the topic of climate change, but I wanted this to be an introduction video on our climate series. Over the next few months, we will be discussing in depth a lot of what I have just touched in this video, from the colonial origins of this mess to how capitalism and imperialism keep this machine running, from fossil fascism to hopeful utopias that have started on this path. For this video, I hope you too firmly believe that there is a specter haunting this world. In my opinion, we need to think beyond the very conservative solutions that the reports advise and advocate for larger scale change. This spectre can only be beaten back by another spectre that was haunting Europe in the mid-19th century, the spectre of communism. We didn't start the fire, but we keep it burning by not working towards overthrowing these systems. Nandri.